and with a tremendous heart for all the peoples of the Middle East and others as well. Pastor Darrell Sutton proclaims the good news of Jesus Christ and introduces one and all to prophetic biblical teachings related to the time of the end. And it's been a long, long, long time, Pastor,
it seems like
since you've been here. And so good to see you again.
So glad to be back with you.
Very appropriate for you to be here as well in these times. But just catching up a little bit, what you been up to these days?
Well, the last couple of years, we've been busy with a lot of traveling and everything. We still trying to work on producing a well-pastored congregation in Nebraska, ministering mm-hmm. the word to them. Dr. Sutton introduced us to World Ministry Fellowship some years ago, more than a decade ago, which is a ministerial alliance, and we were offered the opportunity to come on to executive board there. Mm-hmm. So we've taken on that responsibility, which is a great ministerial fellowship. But in the last 3 years, we've been doing a lot in East Africa.
Hmm.
So lately, I've been on the Kenya-Tanzania border. So mm-hmm. I just wow. got back from a great revival amongst the Maasai tribe. The only way to describe that, the only adjective fit to describe it is the word wow.
Wow.
It was a Book of Acts meeting. It was powerful.
Wow.
Just for God to minister to these people. But across Africa, there are folks that are hungry for God. Mm-hmm. And one area where I was at, they still abduct little children. And you have folks involved with witchcraft and sacrificing the little kids. So you can see why yeah. the need of the gospel is important.
Dark, but light triumphs in those places. Just a little bit on your background. You served 7 years with the United States Marine Corps.
I did. Fiercely patriotic.
Fiercely patriotic. Planting underground churches in Saudi Arabia. You
correct.
Speak seven languages, mostly focused around the Middle East.
Yes, sir.
Middle Eastern languages, and a very astute student and teacher when it comes to the end of times. Mm. So let's kind of get into a little bit of that prophetic element, Pastor, with respect to what we see happening in our world today. I mean, it's been a few years since we've seen you face to face, and so much seems to have happened with the resurgence of Russia and the continuing turmoil that surrounds much of the Middle East. What do you make of some of these themes?
Well, Russia, we immediately have to go to Ezekiel 38. Chapters 35 and 36 of Ezekiel give us the background for what's taking place with the reestablishment of Israel. Chapter 37 then tells us about the unification of it and then the miracle of their unity. Mm-hmm. Nobody's of one tribe. They're just all single as a single entity. Mm-hmm. But chapter 38 gives us the picture of Russia. Here's a group of nations from the north that eventually going to set their sights on Israel because of what was prophesied. So the nature of the leadership of the north in those parts is predicted in Scripture. Mm-hmm. Now, verse 5, I think, is important in Ezekiel 38 because it gives the allies of them in the last days, Persia, Ethiopia, Libya. I've heard people say that Russia did not really get involved in the Middle East until the mid-50s or so around the Korean War. But truthfully, they were involved with Iran right about the time that the revival was taking place with the Jewish people coming back home with Zionism.
Mm-hmm.
So Iran had a 1905, 1906 constitutional revolution. But by 1907, Russia was inside of Iran with strong influence.
Already influencing that region.
Yes.
Wow. The question that Val teased at the beginning, distinction between second coming and rapture.
Right. Rapture relates to the first resurrection. The scripture in 1 Corinthians 15 talks about the first resurrection. Paul says in Thessalonians that the trump of God's going to sound, we which are alive are going to be caught up to be with him. Now, there are people who say that the word rapture is not in the Bible, but it's right there in the text. I've told people it depends on what Bible you're reading. If you're reading a Latin Bible, you've got the word raptus right there in the actual text of Scripture. The difference, though, is the rapture will be the secret gathering of the saints unto the Lord. We'll meet him in the air. There we shall ever be with him forever. And the Scripture says, comfort one another with these words. The second coming, though, will be at the end of the seven-year period of tribulation when the Lord returns with his saints and establishes his millennial reign here on planet Earth.
Okay, so we're going to kind of go back and forth with our questions. Considering modern-day Israel, and America, how would you define or describe that relationship currently, and what impact will it have on us in the future?
Well, the relationship of Israel and America certainly is strong. Mm-hmm. And I think from a prophecy perspective, it needs to remain that way. I mean, it's better to be on God's side than to be an enemy mm-hmm. of God. And certainly Israel is the apple of God's eye, and he cares about those people. In the days in which we live now, and if I understand your question correctly, you want to know how this is going, how these two yes. nations will function together in the
Correct.
Last days. If we take a scripture like Ezekiel 38, starting with verse 10, moving all the way down to verse 14, then we have the allies of Israel who will stand against Persia. So, of course, as Dr. Sutton used to always talk about the young lions, and then he'd always mention Australians, South Africa, America, Canada, places like that. But the young lions that constitute all those that rallied around Great Britain who had the lion on their ensign, mm-hmm. that was really a lot more extensive. So you've got countries in East Africa and other places. There will always be a people that will stand by Israel no matter what is taking place. So God has predicted this in Scripture, mm-hmm. and no matter what the opposition is, that Israel is going to stand.
Now, I know that biblical prophecy, Bible prophecy, obviously, huge cornerstone of Dr. Hilton Sutton's life, mm-hmm. cornerstone of your life as mm-hmm. well. Why is it important for believers to be students of and listeners to mm-hmm. and hearers to biblical prophecy?
2 Peter chapter 1, verse 19 speaks of the word of the Lord being a more sure word of prophecy, and that it being a light in a dark place. Mm. So if a person sitting in a room and somebody shines a light, immediately the first thing they'll recognize is that that light has a very striking feature. So it attracts the eye. Well, Peter speaks of that light as a candle, then as a sunrise, then as a day star emerging in the heart. So it gets bigger and bigger. Mm. He starts off in the context of that, explaining why he was on the mountain with the Lord, and the Lord spoke and said, "This is my beloved son." And he said, "We hadn't received cunningly devised fables." So the scriptures we proclaim, they're not pithy sayings. They're not just proverbial statements or all kinds of aphorisms. Or good wisdom. This mm-hmm. is the predicted word of God. And the person who sets their sights on the prophecies of the scriptures and becomes a student of them receives a perspective and worldview that other people can never have if they don't study the scriptures.
Okay, mm-hmm. Pastor Darrell, let's talk politics. You know, a lot of people are saying if you elect Donald Trump, he's going to do this, and the Bible says it, and it's in end times prophecy. If you elect Hillary Clinton, what are your thoughts on this? And should we even interpret end-time prophecy based on what makes the headlines? I know it's a loaded question, but we see it all the time.
I think that our spiritual climate is changing. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So we have godless people and immoral politicians. However, and I know there are exceptions, where we don't have godless or immoral politicians, we have devout but complacent people mm-hmm. in positions of authority. Here's how I think about politics from a spiritual perspective. The activities of the church, in order for them to go on unimpeded, we need people in a position of power that love God. And we need to pray for people that love God. And we need to pray that God gives us people in this nation that will continue to allow this nation to be the light that produces the gospel. No other nation on the earth produces the gospel, supports the gospel, sends money into mission field like the United States of America. And that's all a part of our Christian foundation. Mm-hmm. So if we continue to allow people who are ungodly to put constraints on Christianity and malign Christianity and then continue to reward them by voting them into office, mm-hmm. we're sticking the knives in our own backs. Mm-hmm. So we need godly people, and those are the kind of folks we should pray for and ask the Lord to give us.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I think with the two people that we have now, when people go into the voting booths, what they're really going to have to ask themselves is, can I put my head on the pillow at night and have a good conscience having cast the vote that I've cast? It's not difficult for me, but everybody has a different understanding of scriptures.
Yeah.
I'm interested in people that want to promote Christ in our culture, that want to preserve the lives of infants. I'm interested in people that are wanting to support what God has in the scripture as it relates to the family and so on. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. We recently had a guest on maybe 3-4 weeks ago, kind of resonating a little bit with what you're saying there, so I just want to clarify. So one of the top considerations is, as the scripture says, pray for our leaders that we mm-hmm. might lead quiet and peaceable lives.
Yes.
So we might be somewhat free to share our faith and to engage in our faith and live out our mm-hmm. faith. And so whether it's economic issues or national security or whatever it may be, mm-hmm. the spiritual liberty of mm-hmm. the nation or the freedom to allow spiritual liberty or freedom of worship is a paramount consideration.
Absolutely. Everywhere I go and traveling across the states and preaching the gospel, I'm hearing story after story of churches are being forced now to allow transgender folks into their bathrooms, or homeschoolers are under attack because of the fact that they teach their children at home. Mm-hmm. I mean, all kinds of stories where Christian organizations are losing their rights. Now, the bad thing about this is that the Christians, the pilgrims who originally came here, loved the Lord. This is how the nation was founded. And then when we had the revolution, it still had those principles that were connected to the creation of this republic that we have. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, though, those same values that have made it possible for people to dissent and have opposing views, those views have now taken the place of Christianity, so that ideology is greater than the ideology of the Bible.
And the freedom to dissent from that is now
narrow-minded,
intolerant,
provincial,
yes,
tolerant,
whatever it be, and not as freely allowed as well.
Absolutely, yeah, absolutely. Yeah. But the church has to go out of its way to speak the word of God. The only mm-hmm. way the word is going to be spoken is the preachers open up their mouths. Now, this is the last day. I mean, the Lord. 2 Thessalonians speaks about a time where there would be a falling away, an apostasy. And undoubtedly, you can see the lines drawn now between mm-hmm. the true Church of Jesus Christ and what can be construed as false mm-hmm. in the teaching of the gospel.
Wonderful. So good to have you with us today.
Oh, so
Pastor
glad
Darryl,
to be here.
And hope to see you again.
We are going to see him again.
See him again?
Yeah, we're going to have him back.
Wonderful.
We're going to do some extra tapings with him.
All right. Thank you so much, Pastor, for joining us today. And to connect with Pastor Darryl Sutton, you can go to revivaltabernacle.ne.org, or as always, go to our website, harvest-tv.com. You'll find an easy way to link back. Still to come, Pastor Mark Lance with today's connections. But up next, we're going to hear from Brian Bush. He's in Petra with a behind-the-scenes look at some fascinating sites in the land of the Bible.